Okay, so this is what we have discussed in the last session, Java compilation and execution process. That day I have explained what are the drawbacks of C and C++, how Java overcome all those drawbacks. I explained in that video, right? So within just 2 minutes I'll refresh it and then I'll go for the next topic. So what exactly happens here? First of all, so generally the drawbacks of C language is C is platform dependent. First of all, if we write a program in C language, that program will be executed only in one system, cannot be executed in other systems. Okay, so that is the first drawback of C language. And the second one is recompilation problem. Every time if you want to execute a C program, compulsory you have to compile it and then only you have to execute it. It's not possible to directly execute the program. Compilation is mandatory for every time. When you want to execute, compilation is mandatory. And the third problem is pointers. Of course, pointers is a very important concept in C language, but still it leads to confusion for the programmer and complexity of the program will also be increased. Most of the virus codes will be viruses programs will be written in using pointers too. That is also one problem. And inbuilt security features are not there for C language. Architecture neutrality. Sorry, it's architecture dependent. That means what? See, if you write one program in one system, see, it depends on that architecture. With some modifications, if you want to execute it in some other systems, compulsory, it's not possible at all because it is dependent on the architecture. So, because of that reason, we shifted to C++, which is an extension to C. Whatever C contains, everything is there in C++. Along with that, it is following the object-oriented programming concepts. So what are OOPS concepts? Next, I will explain very clearly when I'll discussing here in Java. But C++ will also have some problems. The first thing is, because it is an extension to C, now it is also platform dependent. Here also problem, pointers problem is there. Here also recompilation problem there. And moreover, C++ is not pure object-oriented programming language. We have some concepts. See, we have eight concepts available. Those eight concepts we are calling it as a OOPS concepts, object-oriented programming concepts. See, when any of the language, any language, whatever it is, so if any language follows or obeys OOPS concept, then that language is known as object-oriented programming language. Got it? Then that language is known as object-oriented programming language. So what is that language? Let's see, what are the OOPS concepts? Class, object, encapsulation, abstraction, inheritance, polymorphism, dynamic binding, and message passing. The OOPS concepts are same anywhere. See, C++ is object-oriented programming language now. Python too. And Java also object-oriented programming language. Python also object-oriented. See, the object-oriented programming concepts are same. Got it? So there is no separate object-oriented features for Java and separate object-oriented features for Python. It's not like that. The object-oriented programming concepts are same anywhere. It is same in any programming language. But the way of implementing that object-oriented programming concepts in our language, right, that will be differed. The syntax will be differed. See, from inheritance. You are writing inheritance program in one way in C++, in some other way in Java, and in some other way in Python. Got it? So OOPS are same, but the way of implementation will be varied from language to language. So here, whenever a language follows eight OOPS concepts, that is known as object-oriented programming language. But C++ fails encapsulation concept. What is encapsulation? Very briefly, I will explain later further in our Java course, right? We'll discuss it more. When you wrap up, when you combine all the variables and functions together and put it in one place, that is known as encapsulation. Got it? That means, actually, why you are putting inside the class? Because that class provides security for your data and functions. Okay, the class provides security for your data and functions. Because of that reason, you will be using what? See, encapsulation concept. But C++ fails encapsulation concept. Why? Because in C++ we can write a program with using class and without using class also. Got it? So if you use class, the class provides security for your data. If you don't use class, then where is the security for the data present inside the main function? And moreover, you are writing the main function outside of the class. I'll show it to you. See, you are writing a class A. Inside the class, you write everything, whatever the variables you want, right? So where in C++ I am saying. Okay, you are declaring the variables like this and you are writing the member functions like this. Void m1 like that. Some functions you will be writing. But actually, you know, right, every program execution starts from main. Main is the starting of the program, right? That main you are writing outside of the class. So whatever data present inside the class, this class will provide security for the data. But what about the data present in main function? No security, na? So it is not providing full security. It fails encapsulation concept. That's why C++ is object-oriented programming language only, but not pure. Okay. Because of all these drawbacks in C and C++, we shifted to Java. This is the Java compilation and execution process. I already explained in that video. Once again telling you, here you have written Java, demo.java. You have written one program. Whatever the code you will write, that is known as a source code, which contains a high level instructions. Okay. So Java C. What is Java C? Java C means Java compiler. Got it? Java C means Java compiler. What this Java compiler will do? Generally, C and C++ compilers will take the source code, converts that into object code. Got it? Object code means which contains zeros and ones code, machine code. Got it? But here, the Java compiler converts that code, Java code, into dot class file. Java code into dot class file. Dot class file contains what? Bytecode instructions. Okay. Is that bytecode instructions and object code instructions the same? No. Bytecode is different. Object code is different. Bytecode is one type of code which contains, see, highly optimized intermediate code. Bytecode is nothing but highly optimized intermediate code. It is not same as object code. Okay. That day I have shown you the bytecode also. I'll show it to you. Okay, I'll show it to you. One second. So here Java compiler converts the .java file to .class file, which contains bytecode instructions. Okay, fine. Next, every system consists of JVM. See, we will be using different type of OS, right? Some people will use Mac, some people will use Windows, some people will use Linux, and some people will use Solaris. So many operating systems are there. Different people will use different operating systems. Okay. Every OS consists of JVM. What is JVM? Java Virtual Machine. Virtual Machine. Every OS consists of JVM. See here, I have drawn four JVMs here. Every system consists of JVM. Every OS consists of that See, here Windows OS will have Windows related JVM implementation. Linux will have Linux related JVM implementation. Means all OS will have JVM, but all JVMs are not same. Mac will have Mac separate JVM. So Linux will have separate JVM. Like that, no, all JVMs are not same. Every OS will have a separate JVM available. But any JVM can understood bytecode instructions. Any JVM can understood bytecode instructions because that bytecode instructions are designed like that. Okay, see, this is the bytecode. Is that in zeros and ones format? No, it is one type of intermediate code. Okay, intermediate code. So why that name bytecode given? Yes, of course, every bytecode occupies 1 byte of memory. In the dot class file, every instruction occupies 1 byte of memory. That's why that name has given as bytecode. Okay, so all JVMs are different. All JVMs are different, but any JVM can understood bytecode instructions present in dot class file. Got it clear? This point brings the platform independent nature to Java. This point brings the platform independent nature to Java. Okay. So this JVM, what this JVM will do? JVM's main responsibility is converting bytecode instructions to machine understandable format. And finally, you are getting the output. Okay. Then you will get one doubt. Bindu, are you getting any executable file here? Because you said that JVM is converting bytecode instructions to machine understandable format. Are we getting any executable file here? No. JVM internally converts bytecode instructions to that machine understandable format. And finally, you are going to see the output. Please listen here. You should remember one point that in Java, we have two files. Dot Java file, dot class file. That's it. No more executable file. Like in C and C++, we have executable files. Final output is a .exe file. Na? But here in Java, there is no .exe file. Only .java file, .class file. Got it? Here? I'll ask questions at the end of the session. Sure. Okay, please listen carefully. Of course, you are all employees. So, here, see, okay. JVM, this brings the platform independent nature. Coming to this point. Understood? First drawback of C is what? That is platform dependent. No? Here it is platform independent. How Java is platform independent? Because when you write a Java program, after compilation, you are getting dot class file which contains bytecode instructions. Of course, our systems are different. Here we are four members, no? So, say example, all of you guys have different systems. Mine is Windows. Harish will have Windows. Shweta will have Mac and Solaris, Pravalikas and Bagas as is some Linux. Say example, you will ask one question saying that, Bindu, you please share the file so that we'll execute it. Okay, what I will do, I have executed now, I have all files. So, I will share the dot class file to you guys. Then you will ask, is the file executed in our system because our OS are different? Yes, of course. Because, of course, our operating systems are different, but still in our operating systems, we have JVM. Is all our JVMs the same? No. My system's JVM is different. Your system's JVM is different. And some others is different. Depends on the operating system. But still, all JVMs can understand the bytecode instructions present in the dot class file because that dot class file is designed like that. So whenever I send a dot class file to you guys, your JVM, your system contains a JVM, no? That JVM will understood the bytecode instructions present in the dot class file, converts that into machine understandable format, and finally getting the output. Got it? And are you people again compile that file? No, because after compilation only you will get dot class file. That compiled code only I am sharing it to you guys. So no need to recompile again. you can directly execute it. Got it clear? One more point I'll tell you. Some of the people will work on Java. So some people are developers and some people, some application support side or maintenance side, like that. In some other streams, you will be using Java, right? If you are a developer, you need JDK. If you are not a developer, you are not developing the code, but you are using the files what developer is sending. Sometimes the Java people will send jar files to you. You know, Java archive files. Okay. They'll be sharing all these dot class files and jar files to you. You are not a developer. If you want to develop the code, you need JDK. But if you are not a developer and you are using the Java code, by the time when you check your system, if that system is provided by office company, that contains JRE only. It does not contain JDK. There is no JDK permission for your system. You have to use that files and you have to execute it. Na? By that time, only JRE installed in your system. Observe it. I'll show it to you next. Okay. Next topic, that's only I'll explain. So this is what happens here. So this will brings the platform independent nature. What is that? Dot class file is understandable to any JVM. Okay. Now, here Java don't need any recompilation. Yes, of course, because I compiled and I have shared the dot class file to you. Are you recompiling once again? No. You are directly executing it. That's why the name called as Quora. Write once, run anywhere. Or else Quora. Compile once, run anywhere. Once you compile, you can run it for any number of times and anywhere in any system. That is the caption for Java. Quora or Quora. Got it? And here, no pointers concept. Totally pointers concept removed from Java. Full security. Because built-in security features are there for Java language. White syntax will also not there. Okay. And it is architectural neutral. Neutral on the architecture. Neither dependent nor independent. Got it clear? Yes? All of you? Any doubts here?
No, Bin.
Okay. Here, Java software. See, these four points very important here. Java software is platform dependent. Why Java software is platform dependent? Because for every OS, separate Java software available. For every OS, separate Java software available. Windows 64-bit, 32-bit, na? For 64-bit, separate executable file is there, Java software executable file. And for 32-bit, separate Java software executable file. For Linux, separate. Like the Java software is different for different OS. That's why it is platform dependent. Coming to Java programs are platform independent. How? Because of this dot class file only, no? So Java programs are platform independent. Coming to the dot class file, which contains what? Bytecode instructions, no? So this dot class file contains bytecode instructions which are independent, platform independent. Why? Because any JVM can understood bytecode instructions, na? That's why it is platform independent. Coming to JVM platform dependent. Why? Because every OS will have separate JVM, na? That's why JVM is platform dependent, Java software dependent, Java programs independent, and dot class file also independent. Got it? But here we cannot write a Java program without a class up to Java 9 version. But after that, shell scripting is also introduced in Java. Now you can write just like Python, you can write program in JShell directly without using any main method. Got it? So, but generally speaking, in Java, everything, even main method also, you will be writing inside the class only. Okay. See, main method also, you will be writing inside the class only. Got it? So this is what the Java compilation and execution process. Now my topic is JDK, JRE, JVM. Okay. This first thing you should know before going to start our history or some other features of Java, all those things is the first thing is JDK, second thing is JRE, and the third one is JVM, and next one is JSL or API, and here we are calling it as SDK2. Okay, so here JDK or SDK, JDK or SDK, is there any difference between JDK and SDK? Java Development Kit, Software Development Kit. There is nothing difference. Generally, the first version of Java, JDK 1.0 released, right? By that time, they named it as, that kit name they have given as JDK. Later, from 1.2 version to 1.4 version, they changed that name as SDK. And again, from 1.5 version, they are calling it as JDK only. That is the only thing difference between JDK and SDK. Both are same. JavaSoft people, the father of Java is whom? James Gosling, right? He only developed. Okay. James Gosling only developed Java language in 1995, the first version of Java. 1996, the first version of Java, JDK 1.0 released. I explained that history also in that video. Got it? So please go through that. And here, there is nothing difference between JDK and SDK. In the first 1.0, 1.1 version, they named that as JDK. Now you will get one doubt. In the what is JDK? What exactly JDK contains? Let me explain one simple example. You know first aid kit, right? First aid kit. What first aid kit contains generally? Whatever the things needed to do first aid, all those things are available in the first aid kit. Like no spirit or some ointments or a scissor, band-aids, cotton. Okay, all those things are available in the first aid kit. Got it? Coming to the makeup kit. What makeup kit contains? Generally, whatever the things needed for makeup, all those things are there in makeup kit. Same way, when you want to execute a Java program, when you want to write a Java program, when you want to compile or debug or execute a Java program, whatever is needed, whatever the tools are needed, all those tools are available as executable files in JDK. Got it? Java Development Kit. To develop a Java program, whatever the tools, tools means what? Whatever the executable files, all those are available as executable files, all those tools are available in the JDK, Java Development Kit. Got it? Now, what is JRE? Java Runtime Environment. Java Runtime Environment. Here it is Java Development Kit. Okay, or Software Development Kit. Next one is JVM. Java Virtual Machine, and here JSL, Java Standard Library or Application Programming Interface. Let me explain these things using this diagram. Let's see here. This entire thing is JDK, the outside box, outer box. What JDK contains? JDK contains JRE plus development tools. Okay? JDK contains JRE plus development tools. But generally, when you install Java program, I mean when you install Java software, you are getting two folders. One is JDK folder, another one is JRE folder. Okay, inside this JDK folder also one JRE is there. This we are calling it as private JRE, and this we are calling it as public JRE. Understood? When you install Java software, inside Java software, okay, two files will be formed, two folders will be created when you install Java software. Let me show you. See, like this, JDK, JRM, and here when you double click it, you will see another JRE here. Understood? This is private JRE and this is public JRE. I'll explain what's the difference between public JRE and private JRE, everything now. Listen, so what JDK contains? JRE plus development tools. See, development tools means what just now I said, na? If you want to develop a Java program, you need some tools. All those tools are available as executable files inside JDK. Java C dot exe means what? Java compiler. So Java C means Java compiler, which is used for compiling the Java program. And Java dot exe means we can call this Java as Java interpreter, Java runtime environment, or simply for executing the Java program, you will be using Java command, java.exe. I mean for converting bytecode instructions to machine understandable format, for executing the code, you are using Java. JDB, Java debugger. Java P, Java disassembler. Java P means Java disassembler, means which will convert a bytecode to, okay, which will convert a bytecode to human readable format. See, when you compile Java program, you are getting dot class file which contains bytecode instructions. Now when you use Java P disassembler, which will convert, you have only dot class file. Say example, I have written one program, one class, where it contains some variables, some methods, more number of methods, constructors, superclass constructors, subclass constructors, like that. So many things I have written. I have compiled the code, and that dot class file I shared it to you. Now you want to know what exactly that contains. What you will do? You use this Java P disassembler, which will convert that dot class file to human readable format. So that you can understood, at least not clearly, but you can understood what exactly, what are the methods, constructors available in that bytecode, you can understood. Disassembly. Java H, that is a stub generator, like header files, J console. Okay, you see console will be open where, how many threads are executing, live threads, how many, and how much memory occupied. Okay, all those things will be displayed in the J console.
Bindu, one question. For Java, yes, P, you are saying that it'll go back, kada, and human readable format ki. So malli manaki dot java file ela aithe undo ala kanipistada, lekapothe is it a different kind?
No, not like that. Manaku as usual, mean meeku okka sari oka chupisthanu, one second. Ippudu ఇప్పుడు ఇక్కడ ఏదైనా జావా ప్రోగ్రామ్ తీసుకుందాం. ఇప్పుడు మనం ఒక ఒక ఫైల్ తీసుకుందాం అండి, B11 డాట్ జావా. ఆ సిస్టమ్ కొంచెం స్లో అయింది. Okay. Yeah, see this program. Here we have one class, A11. A11 is a class. It contains some static methods, static variable, instance variable, and instance methods. And we have one subclass for the super class A11, where it contains one static variable, one instance variable, one static method, and instance method. Okay, B11. And here inside the subclass, now we have written main method too. And we have written some code, right? This is the program. Okay, because in whichever the class, we can write any number of classes in a program, but at least one class should contain main method. You should save that program with the class name. In whichever the class, the main method is there. Okay, so that's why I saved this program as b11.java. Now it's there in the Java programs, right? Let me. Okay. Java C B11.java. I have compiled. Okay. It's okay. Okay. So this is compiled. Now when I type Java command, Java B11, when I type, you are getting the output. So Java C is used for C. This is what the output you will get it. Okay. Now what I am doing, Java P. I have saved B11.class file to you. I did not save this .java file to you. Java P is the Java disassembler. Whenever you give Java P B11, okay. See, Java P B11. No need to give dot class, because for Java disassembler, we will give dot class file only. Okay, here B11 dot class, no need to give dot class extension. Directly you can give the dot class file name. What it has done? See, Java P disassembler compiled from B11.java. Okay, class B11 extends A11. Here you have taken one static variable. Na? See this one. Okay. And here we have one instance variable na, here. And every time in a class, generally five elements will be there. Variables, methods, constructors, okay, static blocks, instance blocks. These are the five important elements in a class generally. Here I did not written any constructor. That's why it has taken default constructor. Default constructor. Next, I wrote M1 method na? See, M1 method. I have written M2 method na? M2 method. And main method is there na? Main method. And I said na, just now, class contains five important elements. What is that? Variables, methods, constructors, static blocks, instance blocks. Got it? And let's see here, static block is there. I did not written any static block here, but by default it will take system defined static block. I did not written any constructor here. That's why it has taken default constructor. Got it clear? That means yeah. I think this question has asked by Shweta or Pravallika.
Shweta. Pravallika.
Okay. Right. Actually, the thing is, you don't know what exactly contained in that methods, but still you can understand what methods are available in that class by using Java P disassembler.
Okay.
Got it?
Yeah.
Okay. And one more thing is, now by using the Java disassembler, you can just see what are the methods, variables available in that class, you can see. But Bindu, that's not my question. I just want to see the exact code present in that class, Bindu. I don't have .java file. I have only .class file. But still, I want to see the code. See, in this M1 method, what code is there? That I want to see. Then we have Java decompiler. Compiler, what it will do? Converts .java file to .class file. But decompiler converts dot class file to dot java file. We have Java decompiler also. That also I will show it to you. Okay, next. Understood? Any doubt here? There is a difference between Java P and Java decompiler, compulsory. Java P is the Java disassembler which will convert a dot class file to just to human readable format. But Java decompiler, okay, which will convert a entire dot class file to dot Java file. Okay, entire dot class file to dot Java file. That is a Java decompiler. Understood? So when you see this JDK, it contains two parts. One is JRE, one is J development tools. All these tools, Java documentation. For creating the Java documentation, you will use this Java doc command. If you want to execute the applet programs, okay, so when you embed Java code inside HTML code, that is known as applet. So applet viewer is used for executing the applet programs. Okay, but nowadays no one is using that. But these are all the development tools available. Now, when we are going to use JDK, when we are going to use JRE, that I will explain. If you want to write a Java program, compile it and execute it, you need JDK. You are writing the program. After writing the program, you are compiling it and you are going to executing it. Then you need JDK. Without JDK, you cannot compile a code. Without compiled code, how can you execute? Not possible. But no, Bindu, someone has done compiled code. They have directly provided compiled code to me. I just want to use the files in my project and I have to execute it. JRE is enough. Java Runtime Environment or Java Interpreter, we can call it as, or JVM, we can call it as. So if you just want to execute the programs, if you want to just run the programs, okay, Java programs, then JRE is enough. What exactly JRE contains? Set of libraries. What are the libraries? Means in Java, approximately 4,500-5,000 classes are there. rt.jar, runtime.jar, very important jar file, library file, which contains all the class files provided by the JavaSoft people, James Gosling. So all the library files are there. Along with that, we have JVM, Java Virtual Machine. Okay, Java Virtual Machine, which will convert a dot class file to executable file, system understandable format, and some other files related to JRE are also available in the JRE. Understood? So JDK contains what? JRE plus development tools. JRE contains what? Set of library files provided by scientists, plus JVM, plus other files related to JRE. When you will use JDK? If you want to write, compile and execute the program, you need JDK. But if you just want to run the program, no need to compile, already compiled code you have, then you can go with JRE. JRE is enough. But remember one thing, Java C is outside of JVM, Java Virtual Machine. Okay, Java C is outside. Next one is Java P and Java Decompiler. Java P means Java Disassembler, which will convert a dot class file to human readable format. But Java Decompiler, which will convert a dot class file to dot Java file. Okay, dot Java file. Understood all this?
To convert to dot Java file, what is it you said?
To convert to dot Java decompiler, I'll show you. I have that file too.
Is that the command?
No, it's not command. It's outside Java third party thing. One second. JDG UI. JDG UI is a graphical user interface. This is what I think. I can show you. See Java decompiler. JD means Java decompiler. See, you can directly type in the Google Java decompiler. JDGUI, you will get it. This is the graphical user interface. You execute it. First of all, executable file, you click it. It will opens in a GUI format. Then what you have to do is you just select whatever file you want. See, this is Java decompiler. Here I'm going. I'm opening one file. Whichever the file you have. See, say example. Just now we have seen one program, no? D drive Java programs. I have seen one program, no? B11.java. That file I'm taking. But you should not select .java file because it is not a compiler. It's a decompiler. Okay. Mm-hmm. You have to select what? B11.class file. You have .class file. If you want to convert the .class file to .java file, you don't have .java file. You have only class file. You don't know what exactly contain in the .class file. If you use Java P disassembler, it is just showing the method names and variable names, static blocks, constructors, all those. But it's not showing exact code in that file. Yes or no? That's why you have taken this Java decompiler, which will show the code present in that method. Sir. See, selected the opening. Yeah, see here. See, class B11 extends A11, static int A is equals to 50, X is 60, static void main. Okay, super A, B class M1, void M2, super dot M2, system dot out dot println. Okay, this dot X, see void main. Here I have given, let's observe one thing. Here it is. Here I have given args na, name as args, no? But it has taken different. It has taken differently. Because see, the names identifiers, it will take itself whatever the name it wants, right? And variable name. Okay, here I'm printing a not variable. See, entire thing is same. Observe. See, but object name I have given as obj, no? Object name. B11 class object name I have given obj, no? But here it has taken local B11.
Okay, names it is changing whatever it wants to.
Yeah, exactly. And here object.x, obj.m2, obj.m3 now, but here it has taken like this. But still the code is same, entire code.
Okay, got it.
Okay, so this is the difference between Java P disassembler and Java decompiler. Okay, so this is what the topic, JDK, JRE, JVM, and the next one is what? JSL or API, Java Standard Library, JSL or API. So generally speaking, Java library is divided into some parts, each and every part known as package. So when we go to C language, right, I will tell you the exact difference between C library and Java library, first of all. So let me explain that. Here, when you go to the C language, C also will have library. Not only C, every language will have a library, right? So, but Java will have a C library is a good library, but it's not a powerful library. The only thing is, if you want to develop a GUI related program in C language, okay, so then some files are there in conivo.h, okay, conivo.h, and some files are then there in stdio.h, okay, and some functions are available in graphics.h. and some functions are there in DOS.h. Okay, that means what? If you want to develop a GUI related program in C language, all the graphical related functions are not, graphics related functions are not available in a single header file. Those are scattered into multiple header files. Then you have to bring all those header files into your program. Whenever you include all the header files, see, from this DOS.h header file, you are using only one function known as delay function. Because of that function, when you include this header file in your program, that header file contains some 1000 lines of code. Now that entire code is included into your program, which leads to length of the program increase, memory waste, execution time waste. Got it? And because all those graphics related functions are scattered into multiple header files, you should remember all the things. Got it clear? Simple example I'll tell you. When you go to the library, a college library or anywhere, public library, all the books are divided into based on their subject or something, right? If the librarian combined all the books together and put it in one place, so generally speaking, when we were in college days, we will just visit the library yearly once or twice, when if we want to return the books, if they are what known as if we want to pay the late fees or something like that, by that time only we'll go and return the books to the librarian. Otherwise we won't see at all, isn't it or not? That's true. Everyone should agree for that, right? So the thing is, so in the library, all of the books are arranged in a good manner, right? So those are not combined together. So if it is like that, it becomes a very big problem. We have to search entire shelves, right? So, but this is what the problem in C language. All the functions are scattered into different header files, which leads to problem for us to recognize, to remember. And if you want to develop a program, compulsory, you have to include all the header files into your program, which makes the length of the program increases. Got it? So that's why JavaSoft people decided, okay, this is not the right way of putting all the files into the library. We need to develop a library which will become so very easier for the programmer to use the class and to develop. See, if you want to use the classes or methods or anything present in the library, it should be very easy for the programmer. Got it? So that's why they have designed just like college library. Got it? So Java library is divided into some parts, each and every part known as package. A package is nothing but just like a folder or directory. Package is nothing but folder or directory, which contains related classes interfaces. Package is nothing but it is a collection of related classes, interfaces, and methods. Means if you take IO package, all the input-output related classes, interfaces, everything present in that particular IO package. No need to search there, here, not that package, this package, not like that. All the input-output related files are available in the IO package. Like that, they have divided, and we have different type of packages available. All the packages, what are those user defined and the predefined packages, third party defined packages. Again, we have core packages, advanced packages, and mobile packages. All those things we'll discuss it in the next session. Okay, and the very important packages must and should, as a Java programmer, we should be very, we should know everything in the Java API documentation. So java.lang package, IO package, okay. Util package. These are all very, very important packages that we are going to cover in our syllabus. Okay. So that point we'll discuss it in the tomorrow session. And in the tomorrow session, I'm going to explain the very, very important topic in Java, that is JVM architecture. That I will explain, and then we'll go for the Java features and basics of Java. Got it? Any doubts here?
Hello. No, Bindu.
Okay, yeah. May I know who's here? VM. Ah, yeah. Boji?